Welcome to The Long Way Round. Thanks for listening to First Voices Radio. I hope you caught as much of that interview as you could. It's a great guest, as always, with your host, Teokas and Ghost Horse. My name is Malcolm Byrne. I think I might have said that already. And welcome to the show once again. I have a very special guest, one of my fellow country persons. Again, that's two in a row. This seems to be becoming a bit of a pattern. Tonight's guest is Ken Stone, and Ken Stone is a veteran anti-war, anti-racist, social justice, and environmental activist based in Hamilton, Ontario, Canada. He's the treasurer of the Hamilton Coalition to Stop the War, a steering committee member of the Canada-wide Peace and Justice Network, and a former Central Committee member of the Global March to Jerusalem, I should say. Ken has lectured widely about Syria, written a number of letters and articles on the Syrian crisis for the Hamilton Spectator and Global Research, and also appeared numerous times on Press TV and RT, when you could still get it, before it got censored. In 2016, Ken traveled with the second international tour of solidarity with Syria to Damascus to observe the Syrian parliamentary elections of April 2016. On the basis of that visit, Ken wrote a booklet entitled Defiant Syria, which is still available online for a few dollars on Amazon, iTunes, and Kobo. Recently, in the context of the war in Ukraine, Ken coordinated a 14-stop Canada-wide speaking tour for Dmitry Laskaris, who was our guest last week, entitled Making Peace with Russia, One Handshake at a Time. Ken Stone, welcome to the show. How are you doing, sir?
It's a pleasure to be here.
Well, I'm very grateful to have you on such short notice. When I was talking to our mutual friend and co-conspirator, Dmitry Laskaris, last week he mentioned your name in reference to the recent speaking tour that you helped him with across Canada, and he told me some of the fun circumstances along the way. Perhaps you'd like to give me your own version of that story, how things got organized, how you met Dmitry, and how things went with the tour.
Well, Canadians have this naive view that those flowery words that appear on the Charter of Rights and Freedoms, which is part of the Canadian Constitution Act 1982, have some meaning. They apparently give us the right to free expression and the right to association on paper.
Is that kind
but
of
when it comes Canadian, down to it?
Sorry, is that kind of like the Canadian equivalent of the First Amendment or something?
That's right. It's a similar. It's the Canadian equivalent of your U.S. Bill of Rights.
I see.
But when it comes down to it, and you want to organize a meeting and have a speaker, you find out very soon that you don't have these rights in practice. Out of the many many places that we had, 14 stops on the tour, this Canada-wide tour, and there were cancellations and of venues in at least four cities. There were protests that tried to stop Dmitry from speaking in two cities, including in Hamilton, Ontario, at Mohawk College on the mountain here. And there were a number of groups and people, state and non-state actors, who tried their best to sabotage the events. And finally, we're supposed to have on that same Charter of Rights the right to a free press, but as it turns out, the press is owned by, I think, three or four companies in this country, and not one word, and I'm not exaggerating, not one word appeared in the media, the mainstream media, that is, about Dmitry's tour. There was a complete blackout, complete censorship. They would not give him the benefit of one line of quote, or even to mention that the tour was going on. That wasn't the case with the alternate media, such as the independent radio, like Radio Kingston. But unfortunately, we found out the hard way that There's a lot of censorship and repression in this country when it comes to speaking out against the wars that are being waged by our government.
Well, could just give me a little bit of background about your organization for our listeners who may not be familiar, and also where they can find you on the internet.
Okay, well, I am the treasurer of the Hamilton Coalition to Stop the War, and the coalition was formed in November 16th, 2002, in the run-up to the U.S.-UK attack on Iraq. And we've been we haven't had to change the name of the Hamilton Coalition because in that past 21 years or 22 years, there's always been a war. We've been living in a state of permanent war in this country, as in your country. And there is an overall peace movement, a peace organization, an umbrella organization for this country, and it's known as the Canada-wide Peace and Justice Network. It's only 3 years old, and I am a steering committee member of it.
And so what's your, is there a website that people can go and
okay, find? Yeah, website. The Hamilton Coalition to Stop the War has a website. It's hcsw.ca, or you can type out the whole thing, Hamilton Coalition to Stop the War.ca. Okay. And we also have a Facebook page and a Twitter account. We're also just getting on Instagram, a little late, but we're getting there. And the Canada-wide Peace and Justice Network also has a website, CanadaPeaceNetwork.ca.
I see. Well, I was telling Dimitri last week when we were talking, because I had just gotten back from a trip. My parents live on Vancouver Island, just outside of Nanaimo, and they've only just moved into a they call it a retirement village. You know, basically. And I was kind of struck by the level of support that I, you know, like, I get the impression, and I could be wrong because I haven't, you know, spent a ton of time in Canada over the last 25, 30 years, but enough time to know that there's something that feels a little different about this conflict, the current conflict in Ukraine. I mean, I got some feedback from people, you know, older people that living at this retirement village, that one individual in mind in particular, who said that with a straight face, said, this war is a war, like he said, young man, if you value your freedom, listen to me carefully, because this war is about stopping Russia and China. Otherwise, we're going to lose all of that. And he said, you know, I spent my whole life, you know, I was in the Second World War and this and that and the other thing. And I was just aghast at that sort of idea. Where do you think that the Canadian, this rabid level of support in Canada for this particular conflict, what are the origins of it, I guess is what I'm saying?
Well, Canada began as a colonial territory of the British Empire. And in those days, the Canadian ruling class was more, tried to be more British than the British. They were so enthusiastic about the empire.
The loyalists.
And now today, the Canadian ruling class tries to be more American than the Americans. And so this tradition of being a servile accomplice of the empire goes back at least 150 years, more than that, actually. If we're talking specifically about Crimea, goes back 169 years to the Crimean War of 1854. And that's important to this discussion because in 1854, the British and French empires decided to wage a war. It was a war of choice against the Russian Empire. The Russian troops were thousands of kilometers away from either France or England, but those two empires decided that they wanted to contain Russia and prop up the dying Ottoman Empire. And so they sent troops to the Crimean War. And in 1854, the British government stripped Canada of its entire British garrison, 5,000 soldiers, and sent them all off to be cannon fodder in the Crimean War. But they weren't the only ones who went. There were enthusiastic Canadians who also volunteers who joined with the British regulars and went off to fight for the Empire in Crimea. And one of them actually won the Victoria Cross. So what I'm trying to indicate here is that Canadians have always been among the biggest supporters of the empire under which we happen to live. First the British, and then the American Empire. And so that was Canada's first connection to Ukraine. Mm-hmm. But it followed right after that, not many years later, in 1918, when the war ended in Europe, the first World War, the Canadian government under Robert Borden succumbed to pressure from London, and they created an expeditionary force to Russia to join with the White Guard forces who were trying to overthrow the Russian Revolution and return Russia to capitalism. And some of these 6,000 expeditionary soldiers ended up in Ukraine, according to the Canadian Encyclopedia. So Canada's role in Ukraine, direct as a country, goes back at least to 1918. Following World War II, the Canadian government under Lester B. Pearson was terrified that that the countries in Europe might were working people, masses of working people had been involved in the resistance to Nazism. He was terrified, along with the rulers in Washington, that the governments in Western Europe might be overthrown by workers' movements, and there might be revolutions, socialist revolutions. So one of the things that Lester B. Pearson did when he was an undersecretary of state, undersecretary for foreign affairs, was to admit tens of thousands of wartime Nazi collaborators and sympathizers to Canada as citizens.
And I think we're talking about numbers in the hundreds of thousands, are we not?
Well, there were hundreds of thousands who came, but not all of them were.
No, of course,
there were not. There were at least 60,000 collaborators and that came to Canada,
one of them's direct descendant related to our Deputy Prime Minister Krista Freeland. Is that not correct?
You hit the nail on the head. His name was Michael Shomiak, and he was the fourth person in line from Hitler in power in Poland. They took him from Ukraine and put him in charge of a newspaper in Krakow, Poland, where he disseminated Nazi propaganda. First of all, the person who owned the newspaper, their family was Jewish. They were sent off to the concentration camps, and Chomiak took over the newspaper. Chrystia Freeland, his granddaughter, even today she says that she only says good things about her maternal grandfather, Michael Chomiak. She never once mentions that he was one of the leading collaborators of Nazism in Europe. And he was one of those people who was brought over at the end of the Second World War to try and create a constituency for anti-Soviet politics in the country. And to solidify that constituency and build upon it for its foreign policy, its anti-communist foreign policy, Pearson did two things. The first thing he did was he used federal government money to create the Ukrainian Canadian Congress, which was the overarching body for all Ukrainian communities. in Canada, or it was trying to be. There was a previous organization called the AUCC, Association of United Ukrainian Canadians, and they were not sympathizers of the Nazis, but this new Ukrainian Canadian Congress was, and the Canadian government paid for its formation and subsidized this organization right until today. So that's a period of some 70 years. On top of that, Pearson came up with the idea. He's credited with being the architect of the idea of NATO, a Western U.S.-led military alliance to contain the former Soviet Union. And this alliance, of course, dabbled in all kinds of activities which were directed against the Soviet Union and tried to cause trouble for it in many of the countries of Eastern Europe. And following the dissolution of the Soviet Union in 1991, NATO went on the warpath, and it destroyed the former Yugoslavia, it destroyed Libya, it destroyed Afghanistan, and it worked its way almost to the point of destroying Syria. So this U.S. military alliance has been a disaster for the world, especially for the Middle East, where it's left a trail of death and destruction, 4.5 million people dead, and millions, many millions more refugees who fled from the Middle East into Europe and North America.
I notice, and you're wearing a button on your hat. Can you tell
yes,
us what
that
says?
Yes, the button says Canada out of NATO. I wear it everywhere.
What kind of response do you get to do people say anything, or they just kind of look at you?
Some people look at me strangely, but you know, there's a lot of people who agree with the button actually in Canada, only there people are a little nervous about expressing it as blatantly as I do. Because there are, you know, consequences here. Receive a lot of pressure if you are not in favor of Justin Trudeau's and Chrystia Freeland's war, proxy war in Ukraine. So those were some of the things that go back in history explaining why Canada got involved in this war. But that it didn't end there. It didn't end with the formation of NATO. Right after the dissolution of the Soviet Union, the Canadian, Americans probably know a lot about Victoria Nuland, who boasted,
oh, yes,
in I think 2015, she was the Undersecretary of State for Eastern Europe.
Well, I think Assistant Secretary of State now.
Yes. Yeah, she's been in every administration of the U.S. government for the past 30 years. And her crowning achievement was the fact that she boasted in 2015 publicly that the U.S. government, she spent through the U.S. government, $5 billion of U.S. taxpayers' money between 1991 and 2014 to achieve the coup d'etat, the Maidan coup d'etat. But she wasn't alone in this. The Canadian government, under various administrations, both liberal and conservative, spent close to $1 billion in the same period to help bring about this Maidan coup as well. So, as I said, the Canadian governments have always been willing accomplices of the U.S. government, and they helped to bring about this coup. They brought about the Orange Revolution in 2004 as well. So they've been busy little actors in Ukraine from 1854 until 2014. And then after 2014, Canada poured under, once Justin Trudeau came in power and Chrystia Freeland became the foreign minister, she poured hundreds of millions of dollars into Ukraine, and she helped to create Project Unifier, which now they boast here in Canada, trained 33,000 troops to become part of Ukraine's de facto NATO army. And they, among those 33,000 troops, it turns out, they trained as well a number of neo-Nazis, including the Azov battalion. This came out a couple of years ago before
Well, a lot
the
of the,
current
yeah,
war.
I mean, my father, you know, God bless him and stuff, but you know, he's one of those typical Canadian. I mean, I was the same way when I lived there that, you know, you sort of listened to the CBC and took it at face value. Like, it's the CBC, it's our national institution. Surely they wouldn't lie to me. But he was, we were talking and he, you know, he was interested. And I said, finally, I just Googled an article, for, I think from 2018. I said, Dad, you know, look at this. Look at the picture here. This guy is wearing he's a Ukrainian or an Azov battalion person, and he literally had a swastika on his helmet. And I said, Dad, that's not a Photoshop. This isn't fake news. This is for real. But it's hard to find those articles. They've been sort of, you know how they can downgrade stuff on the internet. I mean, the information is still there, but it's really quite appalling how available this information is, yet people don't want to know it, the truth. It seems like they are willingly sticking their fingers in their ears and saying, I just don't want to believe this, no matter what kind of argument you present to me.
Well, there may be people like that, but I think overall, the fact is that our news media in Canada is heavily censored, and things which do not support the war effort in Ukraine are censored out.
Well, as you found out with Dimitri, of course.
Yeah, exactly. It was what happened with Dimitri. But you know, every November 11th in Canada, everybody in Canada is expected to wear a red
Yeah, you
poppy.
get your red poppy and
Remember the
sure.
slogan, lest we forget. I mean, that was all about, a lot of that was about the Second World War. I mean, my parents and my parents' generation were fervently involved in the fight against fascism during World War II. And that's where the slogan comes, lest we forget. But apparently, many Canadians have forgotten that that's what the war was about. And me, right now, our government, our taxpayers' money is going to fund neo-Nazi battalions and groups. In fact, a neo-Nazi government, a government heavily invested with right sector and other explicitly neo-Nazi parties in the government institutions, especially the army and the police forces. And this the government of Zelensky has declared January 1st, a national holiday in
An old
celebration of
Stefan.
Stepan Bandera,
Yeah.
who was the leader of the Organization of Ukrainian Nationalists, which committed heinous war crimes in wartime and post-war even Ukraine and Poland, killing thousands of ordinary Polish farmers and workers and Jews and Ukrainians, anyone who disagreed with their Nazi outlook. And in Canada here, they were provided a safe shelter when they escaped from Eastern Europe. In Oakville, not more than 20 kilometers from here, this past year, I had the opportunity with a few friends to go to the cemetery of the Saint Volodymyr Church, Ukrainian Orthodox Church in Oakville, and they have 400 or 500 graves. With gravestones with the insignia of the Organization of Ukrainian Nationalists, and it's they're all lined up. There's hundreds of them with monuments on both sides of the cemetery to the Ukrainian fascists who fought alongside Hitler, who formed the Waffen-SS, who personed the concentration camps, who were responsible for extermination of Jews and communists and prisoners of war. And this is, right here in my backyard almost. So this is the history of Canada as it relates to Ukraine. Canada has been involved in trying to tear Ukraine away from Russia for 169 years.
I have a question. Well, I have a couple. I've jotted down some questions, and obviously, if there's things that you want to talk about, by all means, take the floor. The only thing I did want to ask you in reference to what we were just sort of talking about was something that Dimitri said to me last week, because you've both been pretty involved with supporting Palestinian rights, as I understand it. Dimitri said he found that the tour and the pushback and the hostility, like he thought it couldn't get any worse than what you've experienced with, or what he's experienced with, you know, supporting the Palestinians in Canada. But he said this was worse. Like he couldn't believe how much hostility there was. What was your observation of that? And why? Well, we've sort of already covered why, but I'd like you to talk more about the tour and some of the anecdotal of events that might have taken place.
Okay. Well, there was hostility towards the tour, but it wasn't from ordinary folks. It was from special interest groups who are connected with the U.S. government or the Ukrainian-Canadian Congress in Canada. For example, for the first stop of Dimitri's tour in his hometown of London, Ontario, a professor named Osap Soroka at Seneca College in near Toronto, mm-hmm. Sent out a tweet encouraging people to disrupt Dimitri's talk in London and in Vancouver. And he called upon his NAFO friends to help him. NAFO, N-A-F-O, is an organization created by British and U.S. intelligence. It's a troll farm, and they have people working for them at minimum wage, trying to counter and cause problems for people who oppose the war in Ukraine. So basically a state actor who was hostile to Dimitri, and the person of a Ukrainian a professor who should know better, because the Canadian Association of University Teachers, to which he automatically belongs, believes firmly in free speech, but apparently he doesn't. There was in Victoria, BC, there was another professor whose name escapes me right now, but she also opposed Dimitri's talk, and she allowed on her Twitter thread, and it was there for one whole month. We've got a screenshot of it, of an assassination threat against Dimitri.
Holy smokes.
It was in French, so maybe she thought people couldn't read French, but it basically said that there was a contract out on Dimitri, and he was likely to be killed because of his opposition to the war.
Wow.
So as I said, that stayed up on a professor's account for close to a month.
That's
at least.
Unbelievable. That's unbelievable. I can't.
Yeah. Well,
you can't
people
make this stuff up. My God.
No, it'd be hard to make this up. But our organizers in Victoria and a couple of other cities, Fredericton, used this as a reason to notify police and ask for police to come by and show the flag at the events, just in case there were people who might be inclined to do something along the line following up on that assassination threat. In Hamilton, where I live, there was a what happened was we had a room reserved at Mohawk College up on the mountain at the Fennel campus. And as we were going in, I and a couple of other organizers saw that there were people in the parking lot with Ukrainian flags and posters in their hands. And they were talking to security guards of Mohawk College, which we found a little puzzling, but we soon found out why. And that was that these people, about 20 of them, decided to come and enter the building they wanted to enter the building with their flags and their posters. And they seem to have gotten word that from, it seems, from the guards, the security guards, that they could come into the hallway in front of our room and have a little demonstration. We kept the door shut to the wing of the college for quite a while until there was some tacit agreement between the security guards, Mohawk administration, and us that, well, they can have the hallway, but we would have the classroom. So we went ahead with the event in the classroom with these people in the hallway, with their flags and banners. They tried a couple of times to come in, but we wouldn't let them in because it was a ticketed assembly. And finally, the Hamilton police came and they agreed with us. It was a ticketed assembly. Well, their leader bought a ticket, and we let him buy a ticket, and he came in, and we gave him a question and a comment in the question period, and he made his little talk, and he thanked us for letting him speak, and after that he left. So I
Which
think
is all fair
we
and reasonable. I mean, that's the way it
yeah.
ought to be. I mean, I don't think anybody in their right mind thinks that, and I sort of played a little bit of devil's advocate with Dimitri last week, for just for the sake of intellectual stimulation, to a little bit of pushback and say, look, sure, of course there are these issues, but we can't absolve Russia of all responsibility and say, oh, they're the victim either. I mean, that would be foolish. There's a film that's only just become available. It's called 20 Days in Mariupol. And it was three young journalists that spent about 20 days in Mariupol. And it essentially shows the horror of being trapped in the city, shelled endlessly. And at that point, it doesn't matter who's shooting the bombs, and it's those poor innocent civilians that are stuck in the middle of it that really, I mean, of course I'm empathetic towards military personnel, but they have some choice in the matter. Whereas if you're just hiding in a basement, not knowing whether you're going to be able to get even drinking water at the risk of your own life, that's a whole other thing. And clearly, in that particular circumstance, it was Russia that was bombing Mariupol. I guess what I'm saying is, what would you say to some, like, what is your response to that kind of pushback from people? And also, the other question I had for Dimitri was, let's go back to February. Was it February 24th, 2022? When the invasion, the special military operation, as they call it, began, people have often said, "Well, there could have been another route." What do you, so answer those two questions in chronological order, if you could, please.
Well, the war didn't start in February 24th, 2022. As I tried to explain, Canada's role in Ukraine goes back 169 years. And actually, the culminating event was the coup, which Canada spent close to $1 billion arranging in the Maidan in 2014.
Which was a
And,
dreadful occurrence. I mean, people were just, the death on the square was just, I saw photographs and video images of that. It was horrific.
well, there were deaths, but it wasn't the Ukrainian security forces who caused those deaths. It's been shown by Professor Ivan Kachanovsky of the University of Ottawa in a peer-reviewed piece, which has now been widely accepted all over the world, that the party that did the shooting of both Ukrainian security police and demonstrators was a third party that was mounted on b tops of buildings around the square. These were snipers that were arranged through U.S. intelligence,
Oh my
and
goodness,
this
jeez.
was done in order to make the Ukrainian security police look bad, make the Ukrainian government look bad. So the U.S. is and in the person of Victoria Nuland has had blood on her hands for a lot longer than 15 months since the special military operation began.
There are rare occasions when you can describe a person as purely evil. I think this is kind of one of them.
Yeah, she is.
I don't know what's going
sure.
on with her and her husband. Isn't she married to like Jane, somebody Kagan? He's a total neocon.
Exactly. But you have to, when you look at the fighting that went on in Mariupol and the shelling, and I'm sure from the point of view of the Ukrainians living in Mariupol and other cities, it was horrifying. But let's not forget that that war started, the war by the Ukrainian government, the coup government, the junta, started in 2015. They took away the rights of Ukrainians to use Russian as a first language.
Mm-hmm.
And they also outlawed the party that the president, who was democratically elected, Yanukovych, had run, called the Party of Regions. Now, Canadians understand that if a government came to power in Ottawa and took away the official status of the French language and banned French nationalist parties such as the Bloc Québécois or the Parti Québécois, there would be an uprising in Quebec overnight. And that's exactly what happened in Ukraine.
Well, I mean, if you go back to 1970, whatever it was, when the FLQ kidnapped Pierre Laporte and the other guy, and we were on the verge of civil war at that point to some degree when you think about it. And that was, that was in Canada. So why would people in that part of the world feel any different,
Exactly. And so what happened in Ukraine following the coup government's removal of Russian as a official language and outlawing their parties and taking away their cultural institutions was a war. It was an uprising in the Donbass, which was followed by an attack by the coup government against the Donbass. And that war lasted until it's still going on, actually.
Yeah, this is just
it
an extension.
Started in 2015. And in that war, innocent civilians in the Donbass were shelled on a regular basis. 15,000 of them died. And 1 million of the Donbass residents had to flee as refugees to Russia.
Yeah, of
so
course.
This was a very serious issue. So, and the Russians tried. The Russians did not intervene in that war militarily. The Russian government under Mr. Putin tried instead to get international support for what they called the Minsk agreements, which were attempts to find a peaceful solution, an end to the war in the Donbass, by reintegrating the Donbass into Ukraine and giving it back its official status as a Russian-speaking area and giving it back its political parties. But it turns out, later revealed by Poroshenko, who was the president of this junta, and also by the German Chancellor Angela Merkel.
Although, there's some controversy about her statement, but I think she was sincere. There was some pushback on that statement, saying that basically she had said, "Well, we just did that to buy more time or something like that."
Exactly. She and the French president, I think it was Hollande, both admitted that they did not negotiate the Minsk Accords in good faith.
Yeah, that's kind of what I was saying.
And that is a terrible thing to say. These were treaties officially recognized by the United Nations. So they were negotiating in bad faith. And the result of their negotiations in bad faith was that the war dragged on for 8 years, and it became the primary cause, in my opinion, of the war in Ukraine today, because the U.S. and NATO were leaving no doors open to Russia to resolve this problem. The Minsk Accords were a dead issue. And then in December of 2021, the Russians issued draft treaties to both the US and NATO, calling for some changes to the status of Ukraine, that being a neutral and demilitarized. By the way, in its constitution of 1991, becoming an independent country, Ukraine officially became neutral. So the Russians were not asking for much. They were asking for a reversal of the coup of 2014. And even that, they couldn't get any satisfaction from the US and NATO. So that left no other alternative to the Russians, especially because in February of 2022, there was a huge buildup by the Ukrainian government, by Zelensky's regime, on the border, on the line of contact, where the fighting took the where the fighting forces were separated, the front lines in Ukraine. So
Well, something
there
that
was about to be an attack on the Donbass, again, Russian-speaking people. And so essentially, Putin was left with no choice whatsoever but to use military force.
Well, I've had I imagine you're probably familiar with former UN weapons inspector Scott Ritter, who's been on this program a number of times. And something that Scott brought up quite often, because he's he was in the Marine Corps and so forth. He said, what America has always done, like what America did in Iraq, for example, was, this shock and awe, like bomb the hell out of the place for a month, drop 200,000 bombs on the place, and then come in and kind of sift through the rubble and see what's left. And he brought up the point that in March of or February and March of 2022, what was perceived as a military failure was essentially the Russians kind of saying, look, we just want you to get to the negotiating table and here's what we're going to do. It wasn't, his point being is if Russia had wanted to flatten Ukraine like everyone pretends or imagines, they could have done it 10 times over. As we're seeing now, they're completely capable of defeating NATO. They're outgunning them or outmanning them. I mean, they're just producing weaponry and tanks at an incredible rate. And so this whole idea that this is a just a war of imperial aggression is just, pardon the expression, bullshit.
I couldn't agree more, Malcolm. This war has been a long time in the making, and I'm sure that Scott and Dmitry both explained to you that NATO expansionism following the demise of the Soviet Union in 1991, after which they at which time they gave Gorbachev a pledge that NATO wouldn't expand 1 inch eastward. All that were lies, and NATO expanded 800 kilometers eastward, took in 14 new countries, and then the coup in Ukraine, right next door to Russia, was, that was basically the final, almost the final straw. So the Russians were, the NATO was prodding the Russian bear for about 30 years before the bear clawed back. And it should be a surprise to no one who knows anything about history that, the US and NATO are using this war in order to try to do to the Russian Federation what they did to the Yugoslavian Federation, which is to destroy it and carve it up and eat gobble it up. And in fact, Chrystia Freeland, who we've referenced before, now she's the deputy prime minister and finance minister. In her budget of earlier this year, no, yes, earlier this year, she said that her wartime budget, with its huge expenditures of military expenditures, unprecedented in quote peacetime, in which, by the way, has given so far to Ukraine $8.5 billion of Canadian taxpayers' money. She said that in her the budget was written because, in her words, it was a budget in order to quote vanquish Russia.
Yeah,
So
well,
we know what the game is about.
the irony being is that you still can't get clean water in Attawapiskat. I mean, it's just ridiculous. Like, I don't know. I mean, I'm Canadian. I understand the psyche. I don't see Canadians rising up in anger and, committing mass civil disobedience methods. But
Not yet, but hopefully soon.
you'd think people would be like, hey, like what in the bloody hell's going on here, you know?
Yes, it's a terrible misuse of Canadian taxpayers' money. We have a health system that's in disarray from the pandemic.
Yeah.
And we've got a housing crisis where tent encampments of unhoused people in every major city in Canada.
Trust me,
including right here in Hamilton, they're right beside City Hall.
I was just on the West Coast. You know, Vancouver is where you end up when you can't afford the bus ticket any further, except maybe the island. But there's even in Nanaimo, like, it was so different from the last time I was there about 3-4 years ago. There's like homeless people all over the place, like all over downtown Nanaimo. And I'm like, I've never seen that before. You know, this is like a quiet little town in, you know, peaceful Vancouver Island, Canada. Not that the homeless people aren't peaceful. I'm just saying it was shocking to me. And I didn't even bother to go to Vancouver and go downtown there because
Well, and now the Canadian government under Mr. Trudeau is bringing in 800,000. It brought in 167,000 last year. Ukraine. Now they're bringing in
immigrants.
A total of 800,000 Ukrainian refugees. I have no idea where they're going to put them. No idea.
Good Lord, this is just nuts. Well, look, we're going to run out of time here, Ken. So I want to kind of focus in on just two more questions. I guess, first of all, in the short run and the long run, where do you think this particular conflict is going to end up? I know what Scott Ritter would tell you.
Well, I'm probably going to say the same thing as Dimitri and Scott Ritter. And I think that the U.S. and NATO and the Boris Johnson of the U.K. scuppered any chance of a peace deal a year ago. In March or in April of 2022, when there was a tentative agreement to end the war, with Ukraine having to make some mild agreements about going back to its neutral status and demilitarizing, denazifying.
But, which I should add, President Zelensky was informally in agreement with until Boris Johnson showed up.
Exactly. And so there's... In the interim, the U.S. and Canada and the rest of NATO poured in endless supplies of arms and funding to Ukraine, and they've undercut any attempt at negotiation to find a diplomatic solution to the conflict. So what I see following Ukraine's failed counteroffensive is that there will be a Russian offensive, and Russia will probably roll across Ukraine as far as Odessa, and Ukraine will probably lose any access to the Black Sea. That's where I see it ending up. I'm hoping, like Dmitry, that there is no accident or unintended consequence that leads to use of nuclear weapons in this kind of situation, because that is always the danger. The danger is that these wars can easily spin out of control into a nuclear confrontation between the great powers.
Well, it's just a kind of endless case of escalation. It's like, okay, we're going to give Ukraine cluster bombs. And of course, Medvedev says, well, you're going to use them, we're going to use them. It's like, and
that's true. And, you know, I'm about the cluster bombs. You know that Canada has taken a position officially. Canada has joined the convention to prohibit cluster bombs. That was back in 2008. And I find it reprehensible. I find it astonishing, actually, that the Canadian government doesn't say that this is a deal breaker. It doesn't say to the U.S., well, we went along with your war all this way, but now that you're making us become party to the use of a banned, prohibited weapon, which shows that you, by the way, that you will not, you have no regard at all for the Ukrainian people, because anybody who cared about the Ukrainian people and children, Ukrainian children for the next two or three generations, knows that these weapons, these cluster bombs, are designed, well, not designed, but they have the practical effect of killing children decades later, as they have
kids
in
are still
Laos,
getting their,
Vietnam.
Vietnam. It was like 50-odd years ago, and they're still getting their legs, arms
That's
blown
right.
off.
Kids are still being blown up in Vietnam and Laos, even till today.
Good Because, you know, the a kid sees a round thing laying on the ground. Hey, what's that? You know, picks it up and bam.
They look like little toys or eggs or something like that. And so kids pick them up and boom, they're either killed, or adults, farmers, you know, are tilling the soil. They lose legs and arms. It's horrible. So, and anybody who has any regard for the people of Ukraine would not use this weapon.
Well,
and
that's what I think anybody
should have said at this point.
I think anybody who had
this is a deal breaker. We're out of this war.
Yeah, no, I agree. I think anybody who had a heart would say stop arming Ukraine, because the only people that are really suffering in this war are the Ukrainians, really.
Well, the Ukrainians are the sacrificial lambs of NATO in its war against Russia, the Russian Federation. And the more than one American politician has said that this is a great war because we get to use up all our old weapons.
Yes, Adam
and
Schiff.
We have to produce new ones. And not a single American soldier is dying. It's all Ukrainians who are dying.
I think Lindsey Graham said this is a great, this is a, I'm paraphrasing. The gist of it was, we're getting a really good deal here. This war is a bargain.
Yeah.
You know.
Exactly.
Like, that they is will, so you, cynical, you know, it's. So cynical.
Well, you know, the Americans had no regard, NATO too, which Canada belongs to, had no regard for the rights of Yugoslavians. They didn't care about the Afghanis either, despite all their pleas about the women training, sending Afghani kids to girls to school. They didn't care about the people of Libya, where there are now slave trades and open slave markets in the city squares. None of it, for all their professed cares about the people of the countries they've invaded, the fact is that they don't give a damn about any of those people. They're just units to be used up. And that's how they treat the Ukrainians. The Ukrainians are to be fought there to fight to the very last Ukrainian. And that's the hypocrisy of this whole thing. NATO is not trying to help Ukraine. NATO is using Ukraine as a battering ram against Russia.
Yeah.
And the sad thing, which Dmitry and others point out, is that, you know, the world can't afford this. We are in an existential crisis here with the environment. And we also we have a health crisis still left over from COVID, and it's and other diseases are spreading rapidly as well. The only way we're going to be able to handle these existential world global crises is with international cooperation, unprecedented international cooperation, and that's not going to happen if NATO is waging a war against the Russian Federation. So that's the really sad part about it, is even if we manage to avoid a nuclear catastrophe in this war, we are not going to get the kind of cooperation that's necessary to mitigate against climate change.
Yeah, and meanwhile, you know, they're constantly tightening the noose around China, and they're bullying Iran. It's like, well, they really think they're, you know, when was the last time you heard about a country opening up a three-front war and that being successful? That was World War II.
Well, the U.S. has had 30 years since the end of the dissolution of the Soviet Union, and they were the sole superpower in a unipolar world. Now they are refusing to accept they are no longer the cock of the walk, that there are other powers that have come forward in the world. It's a multipolar world now, and they can't come to terms with it. And they think they can still throw their weight around and promise a war against China over Taiwan in 2 years, and they can beat Russia, and they can, you know, bring down the Iranian government. They can't do it, but they're getting increasingly reckless, and that is a dangerous situation for the people of the world.
Well, you know, when 100-year-old guy gets on an airplane and flies to Beijing and gets treated like a royalty on a 14-hour flight named Henry Kissinger, and you're actually going, wow, like, you know, I prefer this guy to this, you know, because I know how I felt about Henry Kissinger for most of my life, you know.
Right.
It's not exactly my favorite person, but
no, war criminal.
But even he's like, this is not right, and like, something's got to change, and nobody seems to be Well, look, I want to leave listeners with some optimism and positivity. So what's your advice to people who feel aware but feeling a bit overwhelmed and helpless? What would your advice be? What are things we can do?
Well, there are things people can do, and you know, we have in historically opposed wars, and we've actually ended wars or helped to bring about an end to war, such as in the Vietnam War. Mass protests did help bring about an end to the war. People demonstrated in Canada in the hundreds of thousands back in 2002, early 2003, and were probably instrumental in preventing the Chrétien government, the Liberal government of Canada then, from joining the outrightly putting boots on the ground as part of the coalition of the willing in Iraq.
Jeez, and so, I was just about ready to give old Jean Chrétien a bit of credit.
Well, you know, he does deserve a bit of credit, but it didn't happen by itself.
Right.
There were 250,000 people who marched in Montreal, 125,000 in Toronto, and 75,000 under his window in Ottawa on the Peace Tower. And so he had some incentives not to join the coalition of the willing. So we've done it before. Or we've helped to do it before, and I think we could do it again. I think this war is becoming increasingly unpopular. The polls show that two-thirds of Canadians now oppose any further sending of arms or funding to the Ukrainian government, though you wouldn't know it from the MPs in Ottawa, not one of whom will support that notion, even though the two-thirds of Canadians do. And 25% of Canadians now want, or at least several months ago on the first anniversary of the war, wanted to see a negotiated settlement of the war. So, you know, as with all the other wars of the empire, they are popular somewhat at first, but as the war goes on and prices go up and people, you know, bodies come home in bags, and there doesn't seem to be an end in sight, people start losing their enthusiasm for these wars. And now is the time for Canadians and Americans to join local peace groups and get involved in opposition to the war. I do believe that there will be a global mobilization against the war in Ukraine in the week of September 25th.
Okay.
So in that whole week, I believe there will be huge mobilizations and demonstrations all around the world.
Great.
And, you know, people in Kingston, New York should join them.
Well, that's good to hear, and I'll definitely be there. Well, Ken, this has been a fantastic discussion. It's been really emotionally vibrant and informative, and I'd love to have you back on the show in a couple of months, and we can check in and see where things are at. You know, maybe we could get you and Dimitri on the same call together. That would be kind of cool. So,
I'd be delighted.
Yeah. I hope I get to meet him in person at some point. So, Dimitri, if you're listening, I think he's in Greece right now having a nice time with his family or whatever. Well, look, I'm going to let you go. And in the second hour, if you want to tune in, you can tune in through the Radio Kingston. Just go to radiokingston.org and you'll hear some of the music that you've selected. And I threw in a few pieces of my own. I hope you find them interesting enough. So be well.
Thank you. I will listen, probably to the recording.
Okay. Well, I will send that to you. All right. Take care, bud. Be well.
Thank you very much for the opportunity.
Yeah, my pleasure, as always. Welcome to Hour 2 of The Long Way Round. I'm your host, Malcolm Byrne. I hope you enjoyed that excellent interview we just had with Ken Stone of the Hamilton Peace Coalition. Always learn something new, and that's as long as you're learning new things, you're young at heart. That's kind of what I think. Speaking of new and old things, I'm going to play a track that Ken suggested, which by an artist whom I greatly admire. I became first aware of Low Key through Chris Hedges a year and a half ago, and he's always been a very outspoken rapper. I forget what he's either of Iraqi or Syrian or Palestinian descent. I can't remember what, but here's a great track. I've played this a few times, and Ken suggested this, and I totally agreed on a track called Long Live Palestine by Low Key.
This is for Palestine, Ramallah, West Bank, Gaza. This is for the child that is searching for an answer. Wish I could take your tears and replace them with laughter. Long live Palestine, long live Gaza. Palestine, Ramallah, West Bank, Gaza. This is for the child that is searching for an answer. Wish I could take your tears and replace them with laughter. Long live Palestine. While we listen to tunes made by ignorant fools, Israel blocked the UN from delivering food. They bring in the troops and you won't even glimpse of the news. They make money off the products that we're quick to consume. And it's not simply a question of differing views. Forget emotions, this is facts, what I spit is the truth. Makes no difference if you're a Christian or if you're a Jew. They're just people living in different conditions to you. They still die when you bomb their schools, mosques and hospitals. It's not because of rockets, please God, can you stop this all? I'm not related to the strangers on the TV, but I relate, cause those strangers could have been me. Words can never ever explain the raw tragedy. It's not a war, they're just murdering more rapidly, and we are automatically supporting pure savagery. Imagine how you feel if this was your family. Palestine remains in my heart forever. We stand for peace, times of war, we shan't surrender. Remember, it didn't start in this dark December. Every coin is a bullet if you're Marks and Spencer. And when you're sipping Coca-Cola, that's another pistol in the holster of them soulless soldiers. You say you know about the Zionist lobby, but you put money in their pocket when you're buying their coffee. Talking about revolution sitting in Starbucks. The fact is, that's the type of thinking I can't trust, let alone even start to respect. Before you talk, learn the meaning of that scarf on your neck. Forget Nestle. Obama promised Israel 30 billion over the next decade. They're trigger happy and they're crazy. Think about that when you're putting Huggies nappies on your baby. Just a war over stolen land. Why do you think little boys are throwing stones at tanks? And we'll never really know how many people are dead. They drop bombs on innocent girls while they sleep in their bed. Don't get offended by facts, just try and listen. Nothing is more anti-Semitic than Zionism. So please don't bring bad vibes when you speak to me. There's plenty of rabbis that agree with me. It's your choice what you do with this message. Don't get it confused, I view this from a human perspective. How many more resolutions have to be violated? How many more children have to be annihilated? Israel is a terror state, they're terrorists that terrorize. I testify, my television televise, I'm telling lies. This is not a war, it is systematic genocide. But whatever they try, Palestine will never die. Palestine, Ramallah, West Bank, Gaza. This is for the child that is searching for an answer. Wish I could take your tears and replace them with laughter. Long live Palestine, long live Gaza. Palestine, Ramallah, West Bank, Gaza. This is for the child that is searching for an answer. Wish I could take your tears and replace them with laughter. Long live Palestine, long live Gaza.
2, 1, 2, 3, 4.
followers.
When strangers are coming, they come to your house, they kill you all and say, "We're not guilty, not guilty." Where's your mind? Humanity cries. You think you are God, but everyone dies. Don't swallow my soul, our souls.
Хочется просто любить и дышать, и мне другого не нужно. Такой, какой есть, и меня не сломать, и все потому что я просто любить и дышать, и мне другого не нужно.
конца. Я русский, моя кровь от отца.
That was Shaman with I Am Russian. And that track, I was very interested in playing that because I bookended a Ukrainian and a Russian song, both asking for peace and understanding between not only their own countries, but other countries in the world to understand. The lyrics to I Am Russian, it's not a patriotic song, but, you know, I'd be hard-pressed to find one out of five Americans who don't love this country. So why shouldn't a Russian love their country any less or more than we do? Makes perfect sense to me. Doesn't mean you support your government or anything else. It just means you're a peace-loving citizen of your own beautiful country, of which Russia is an incredibly beautiful country. As is, and unfortunately, some parts were beautiful of Ukraine. Before that, we heard the track by Jamala, 1944, which was kind of a rewriting peace song done by a modern Ukrainian artist. Here's it.
We start with a country, a country, a country, with lithium, bananas, oil, or gold. Then send in the army, marines, mercenaries, the navy and air force till we overthrow. And who does the killing, the killing, the killing? A soldier, a sailor with gun in their hand. They follow orders and say they are willing to destroy a place that they don't understand. They come from the farms and the factories, offices, classrooms and trades to fill in the ranks. They come back broken in mind and their bodies used up by the weapons, dealers and banks. And who gets the profits, the profits, the profits of 100, 1,000, 2,000%? It comes from the pockets, of people you think would be recalcitrant. It goes to the makers of abominations, mathematical manipulation. A simple corporate war calculation, out of your paycheck they call it taxation. You pay for the wheeling and dealing and stealing. You pay for the bullets and bombs and the tanks. Napalm and nukes and lobbyists sell it. Did GE and Westinghouse ever say thanks? War is a racket, and who does the killing with missiles and mortars, grenades and guns? They come back broken in mind and their bodies used up by the Raytheon politicians.
Let me tell you the story of a line that was held, and many men and women whose courage we know well. As they held the line at Peekskill on that long September day, we will hold the line forever till the people have their way. Hold the line, as we held the line at Peekskill, we will hold it everywhere. Hold the line, We will hold the line forever till there's freedom everywhere. There was music, there was singing, people listened everywhere. The people, they were smiling, so happy to be there. While on the road behind us, the fascists waited there. Their curses could not drown out the music in the air. Hold the line, hold the line. As we held the line at Peekskill, we will hold it everywhere. Hold the line, hold the line. We will hold the line forever till there's freedom everywhere. For the grounds were all surrounded by a band of gallant men. Shoulder to shoulder, no fascist could get in. The music of the people was heard for miles around. Well guarded by those workers, their courage made us proud. Hold the line, hold the line. As we held the line at Peekskill, we will hold it everywhere. Hold the line, hold the line. We will hold the line forever till there's freedom everywhere. When the music was all over, we started to go home. We did not know the trouble and the pain that was to come. We got into our buses and drove out through the gate. We saw the gangster police, their faces filled with hate. Hold the line, hold the line. As we held the line at Peekskill, we will hold it everywhere. Hold the line, hold the line. We will hold the line forever till there's freedom everywhere. Then without any warning, the rocks began to come. The cops and troopers laughed to see the damage that was done. They ran us through a gauntlet to their everlasting shame. And the cowards there attacked us, damnation to their name. Hold the line, hold the line. As we held the line at Peekskill, we will hold it everywhere. Hold the line, hold the line. We will hold the line forever till there's freedom everywhere. All across the nation, the people heard the tale and marveled at the concert and knew we had not failed. We shed our blood at Peekskill and suffered many a pain, but we beat back the fascists and we'll beat them back again. Hold the line, hold the line. As we held the line at Peekskill, we will hold it everywhere. Hold the line, hold the line. We will hold the line forever till there's freedom everywhere.
Where have all the flowers gone? Long time passing. Where have all the flowers gone? Long time ago. Where have all the flowers gone? Young girls pick them, everyone. When will they ever learn? When will they ever learn? Where have all the young girls gone? Long time passing. Where have all the young girls gone? Long time ago. Where have all the young girls gone? Gone to young men, everyone. When will they ever learn? when will they ever learn? Where have all the young men gone? Long time passing. Where have all the young men gone? Long time ago. Where have all the young men gone? Gone to soldier everyone. When will they ever learn? When will they ever learn? Where have all the soldiers gone? Long time passing. Where have all the soldiers gone? Long time ago. Where have all the soldiers gone? Gone to graveyards, everyone. When will they ever learn? When will they ever learn? Where have all the graveyards gone? Long time passing. Where have all the graveyards gone? Long time ago. Where have all the graveyards gone? Gone to flower everyone. When will they ever learn? When will they ever learn? Long time passing. Where have all the flowers gone? Long time ago. Where have all the flowers gone? Young girls pick them, everyone. When will they ever learn? When will they ever learn?
That's about all the time we have for tonight's program. Please stay tuned for Freedom Highway with your host, Nick Pankin, who will be spinning some discs for the next couple of hours. I'm going to go out with a piece by Bill Evans called Peace, Peace. Thank you, Ken Stone. Thank you so much. And thanks for listening. And if the good Lord's willing and the creek don't rise, we'll see you next week. Be well.